All right. Revelation 1 through 11, as we looked at before, is this series of visions that unfolds before the apostle. He sees the throne scene. He sees the Lamb who's worthy to open the seals. We see those seals opened up. We see the seven trumpets being blared out. And all these things generally being the idea of God acting against the enemies of Christ and taking his vengeance on them, punishing them, things like that. In chapter 12, it shifts scenes, it switches over and begins to talk about this woman, and this woman who gives birth to the child, and the dragon appears and wants to destroy that child, but the child is caught up to heaven, and then the dragon turns against the woman and against the offspring of the woman and things like that. And we talked about that idea being God's faithful people and the dragon, the devil, going after them. Now, in chapter 13, we see more of the dragon, but we also see these two beasts that appear in this vision. And maybe chapter 13 is one of the more famous chapters out of the book of Revelation because of the beasts that are described here. So we want to look at them and notice the beast from the sea and the beast from the earth, and then what they indicate in the context of the letter as it was originally written. So let's read Revelation 13, 1 through 10. 1 through 10. Who will grab that for you? Ron?
Then I stood on the sand of the sea, and I saw a great beast rising out of the sea, having seven heads and ten horns, and on his horns ten crowns, and on his heads a blasphemous name. Now the beast which I saw was like a leopard. His feet were like the feet of a bear, and his mouth like the mouth of a lion. The dragon gave him his power, his throne, and great authority. And I saw one of his heads as if it had been mortally wounded, and his deadly wound was healed. And all the world marveled and followed the beast. So they worshiped the dragon who gave authority to the beast, and they worshiped the beast, saying, "Who is like the beast? Who is able to make war with him?" And he was given a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies, and he was given authority to continue for 42 months. Then he opened his mouth in blasphemy against God, and blasphemy his name, his tabernacle, and those who dwell in heaven. It was granted to him to make war with the saints and to overcome them, and authority was given him over every tribe, tongue, and nation. All who dwell on the earth will worship him, whose names have not been written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. If anyone has an ear, let him hear. He who leads into captivity shall go into captivity. He who kills with the sword must be killed with the sword. Here is the patience and the faith of the saints.
Okay. So you've got this beast arising out of the sea. Now, you may have noticed that we have an alternate translation. I believe Ron is in the New King James. If you're in the ESV, 13:1 in the New King James is essentially tagged on the end of chapter 12. And instead of saying, "I stood on the sand," it says, "He stood on the sand." So the last picture we had was of the dragon and activity of the dragon. The idea is probably that the dragon is standing on the edge of the seashore and looking and waiting and anticipating this beast to come up out of the sea. And John is there witnessing what is unfolding there. Now, the sea, what could the sea indicate? We're going to get into who the beast is and all of that in just a minute. But the sea, what could that potentially indicate? Okay, people, nations, groups, the sea of humanity is sometimes indicated by the sea. You think about where they are in Asia Minor as well, that the sea is the thing that very much contacted or connected them to Rome. Rome was just across the sea, so to speak. You have Rome being dominant around the Mediterranean, and so that's kind of their territory, things like that. But whether it's the Sea of Humanity or some other indication here, this great beast comes up out of that sea. And what does he have? How is he described in 13:1? What's that?
Seven heads, ten horns, horns, ten crowns.
Okay. How was the dragon described before? Chapter 12, verse 3, for reference. Seven heads, ten horns. This beast has seven heads, ten horns. Now, does that mean they're the same? What does that mean? Anybody?
Similar,
but not identical. And just this is just a little bit of a minor point here. Very often in this prophetic language, we see things that are similar, but not necessarily identical. We just have to be careful to sort through those things. But the idea is, he is closely associated with the dragon. That it's almost like you have a dragon and you have a mirror of that dragon, or you know, a duplicate of the dragon in a sense. Clint? Right, right, exactly. And so he has these seven heads, being intelligent, has these ten horns, which indicates what?
Power,
and there's some specific application that we'll talk more about in just a minute, about that power, where that power rests, if you will. Ten crowns, he has authority. And on his head, the blasphemous name. So I asked in question one, the beast has blasphemous names on his head, with the understanding of the history behind the book, to what could that refer? Why would he have these blasphemous names written on his heads?
Is it displaying arrogance towards God and rebellion against God?
Yes. It would be arrogance, it would be rebellion. As we'll touch on in a little bit, these rulers in Rome, particularly Domitian and some others, they took to themselves divine honors. And they,
be that idea that they were wanting to be portrayed as gods themselves, and by doing that, they were producing
exactly. That would be the most concrete example of where they did take on, you know, Lord and God. They wanted to be addressed, or Domitian at least, wanted to be addressed Lord and God. So that here are these blasphemous names, rebelling against God, contempt before God. Like they had the power, the control, the wisdom, all those kinds of things, and not giving any honor or deference to the true God in heaven. So he's very similar. This beast is very similar to the dragon. In question number two, I asked you to compare the image of the beast here with that found in Daniel chapter 7. What is similar? What we can learn? Can we learn about the identity of the beast? So let's just take a quick peek at Daniel 7. Daniel chapter 7. And Daniel chapter 7, tell you what, let's read here verses 4. Let's go 4 through. Let's go 4 through 8. Who will grab that for us? Go ahead, Hank.
The first was like a lion and the eagle's wings. I watched till its wings were plucked off, and it was lifted up from the earth and made standing on 2 feet like a man. And a man's heart was given to it. And suddenly another beast, a second like a bear, it was raised up on one side, and there were three ribs in it, its mouth between its teeth. And they said thus to it, arise, devouring much flesh. And after this I looked, and there were another, like a leopard, which had on its fact, four wings of a bird. The beast also had four heads, and dominance was given to it. After this, I saw the night vision, and behold, the fourth beast, dreadful and terrible, exceeding strong. It had huge iron teeth. It was devouring, breaking in pieces, and trampling the residue with its feet. It was different from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns. And I was considering the horns, and there was another horn, a little horn, coming up amongst them, before the three of the first horns were plucked out by the roots. And there is this horn, where eyes were like the eyes of a man, and the mouth speaking pompous words.
Okay. So when you read that, and you read about the beast, you know, here's four beasts in Daniel 7, and there's one beast from the sea in Revelation 13. What are some of those similarities that are in there?
The animals that are used.
Okay, the animals that are used. And we've got what in these? Just let's list them out real quick. Yep, leopard, lion, bear, and what's that? Okay, yeah, bird and eagle. So,
And the pompous words could be like arrogance.
Yes, yes, very much so. The arrogance coming out about thinking themselves as greater or more powerful than they really are. It talks about, you know, this 10 horns being involved. So it's not an exact match between the beast described in Revelation and the beasts, plural, described here. Not exact, but there's enough similarities to look at that and go, oh, okay, there's a connection here between the two.
And they're also coming out of the sea.
Mm-hmm.
The Lord and Daniel are coming out of the sea. This is coming out of the sea. So, more similarities of where they come from.
Right, right, exactly. Now, when you look at Daniel 7 and you see these four beasts, if you keep on reading down, do you remember the explanation that Daniel has given about this? Anybody remember? Let's back up. Daniel chapter 2, what did Daniel see in a vision? Oh, okay. So, in Daniel 2, he had a vision, or Nebuchadnezzar had a vision, then Daniel interpreted that vision, and he says, look, these are four kingdoms, and you're the head of gold, and there's going to come another after you that's inferior to you, so the Medes and Persians, and he said there's going to come another one after that, it's going to be the bronze, and that's going to be, you know, the Greeks, essentially, and then there's going to be this fourth kingdom, it's going to be iron, iron and clay, it's going to be really powerful, but then the kingdom of God is going to come, and it's going to destroy that, wipe all those out, and it's going to exist forever. So, Daniel chapter 7, he's getting the same message again in a different vision. Here's four beasts, here's four kingdoms that are coming, and here this fourth kingdom is going to be unlike, but sort of like the others that came before, because the Romans absorbed all those others that came before, essentially. But here, you've got these four kingdoms that are being laid out, and so you've got this similarity between the two. So Daniel was pointing forward to the Roman Empire. And here in Revelation chapter 13, it just is overwhelming. Okay, he's talking about Rome. He's talking about the Roman Empire. And maybe talking about a very specific ruler in the Roman Empire as he gets on down through here. Who was persecuting the children of God at the time. But any other thoughts there?
Well, Daniel 7, I think he's told to seal it up, that he can't know the interpretation, and then, like, Revelation, where it comes about, it's like he's revealing what Daniel saw.
He's making a definite application here. Here's who we're talking about. And it helps, each of them help the other to be understood and explained in what is revealed there in the apocalyptic language, which is quite foreign to us at times. But be that as it may, Revelation 13 again, as he's describing this beast, he says, you know, I saw one of its heads as if it had been mortally wounded, and its deadly wound was healed. The world marveled and followed the beast. That's probably a reference to Nero, Nero's death, and then Domitian. As Nero was a great persecutor of Christians, and he was more localized in his persecution, Rome essentially. Domitian went empire-wide to persecute. He went after them with a vengeance. Now, here's the thing. Some of the reading I did is, when Nero died, that there were rumors in the empire about that he didn't really die. That he was being hidden by someone, or he had escaped to the east, and he was going to come back with a Parthian army, and he was going to rule again, establish his rule again. So there were all these rumors. Now, that to me is just like, you know, Elvis or JFK. Oh, they really didn't die, really didn't die. It just goes to show that whenever somebody who is such a powerful and influential figure dies, people have a hard time processing that. And they're going to listen to any type of conspiracy and think, oh, that, no, it's really not that way. This person's actually still around. They're going to come back, and isn't that going to be great? Or maybe that they're scared of it, whatever it might be. But the idea was that John is taking this and playing on that rumor or that common misconception about it and just simply saying, look, the Nero coming back is actually Domitian. It's just the spirit of that ruler really is coming back. And he hates Christians, and he is trying to get rid of them and destroy them. So that's the idea of it's mortally wounded, but then that wound is healed. Any thoughts up to that point?
Stephen, I wanted to ask, in both cases, it says that authority was given unto them. And it is a destructive authority. Mm-hmm. So can you comment on the commonality between authority that was given to both of these?
Yes. I would say it's probably my first preference to understand that is they're given authority by the dragon. The dragon is the one behind them, motivating them, you know, pushing them, leading them in that way. But also there is a sense in which God grants permission to Satan, and then therefore to the beast, to operate in this world.
Would that be the case in Daniel, that it would be God that gives that authority?
Allows that to unfold, yeah, in that sense. And that's sometimes also where we get tripped up. We think if God allows something, that God's approving something, and He's not. God gives us free will. That doesn't mean God approves of all the decisions and actions we take. And so here he's sort of saying, you can operate just like He did in Job. Hey, you can go after Job, because He had confidence in Job. You can go after him, but only this far. And we've kind of seen that in this letter so far. Look, you can hurt men, but you can't kill them. You can do this, but you can't do that. Andrew and then Mike.
Just that when Nero died, you had a civil war in Rome, which was the first time that happened, was it said it became an empire as opposed to the Roman Republic, which is didn't last long, our thing. But when you lived there at the time, you have the head falling apart, and it looks like maybe something, but now it's still back up and went on.
Right, right. Mike.
Yeah, I don't want to get too far out to the weeds or anything like that. Do you think this has anything to do with what John's talking about the spirit of Antichrist already in the world, you know, obviously to be a person?
Yeah, that's a can of worms.
Yeah, you don't want to go there, that's fine.
He was definitely Antichrist. And yes, just a quick side note. Antichrist, my understanding is just any spirit that is against Christ. That's that, not a specific individual, which, you know, some people, though, identify it with the papacy and different things like that. But.
Well, when I look at all of this, those Christians were being told what they probably were realizing every day, which is Satan was at work through governments, through power, through political strength. That there was no source on earth that was going to be a solution for them.
Right. Yeah, the picture that is clearly being drawn here is the devil is the puppet master who's pulling the strings. Don't be deceived about this. This is why this is happening to you, because it is Satan in a full-out attack. We'll dig a little bit more on that in just a minute. But it says here in verse 3, you know, all the world marveled and followed the beast. So they worship the dragon, and they talk about who is like the beast, who is able to make war with him. The people at the time, and Christians probably also had this viewpoint, who could take on Rome? I mean, they've got their legions, and they've got this power. Who in the world could really take them on and bring them down? Who can bring an end to this persecution against us? And you could, standing there on the stage of the world at the time, you couldn't just see that. Yes, there are people who can resist Rome, and there are people who harass Rome, but who could take them down? And the answer would have been, well, nobody. Really, if you look at the world just as a man, through man's eyes. But as they're doing this, it says that they're worshiping. And question number 3, I said, who do the people also worship as they worship the beast? And any lesson for us today? They worship the beast. Who are they worshiping?
The dragon, because he gave them the beast and the power.
Exactly. They're also worshiping the dragon. So today, any lesson? Okay, if you worship at the feet of government, you're worshiping the dragon. I'm just going to... we need to understand that the whatever entity that we are elevating, that we are adoring, if you will, that we pay homage to, whatever that is, whether it's a governmental body or if it's a celebrity or if it's a hobby or a job or whatever it is, it's just another way to talk about idolatry here. And the one behind idolatry is Satan. And Satan sometimes does that through these institutions like government. Sometimes he does it through entertainment. Sometimes he does it through sports. Sometimes he does it through material things. He does it in different ways. He just so happens here in Revelation 13 to be talking about the government, the very powerful government that people did idolize because of its great power, its might. Mike?
Place, therefore, it seems as if this government that is being established stands against what God put the governments there for. It can't stand, it's going to collapse, and that's what we see. And we see that over and over in any kind of government that moves away from God. It ends up collapsing.
Right. And for us, it's kind of hard to see that because we have this little bitty sliver of a view, because we think, oh, well, the Communist Party of China just celebrated 100 years. You know, why doesn't God bring them down? They're anti-God. God's going to bring them down. He'll do it in His time and in His way. It's not up to us to determine and judge God and His workings in this world. And that would have been similar to these people. You know, God, how long? How long are you going to let this go on? Just be patient. I'm going to take care of it. But yeah, when they go against God, it will fall apart. Your family goes against God, your family's going to fall apart. The church goes against God, that church is going to fall apart.
The foundation is built upon sinking.
Right.
So that's why they don't.
Exactly. So then we get into this section of 5 through 7 where the beast is very arrogant, very powerful, blasphemies against God. Against God, against His being, against His very existence. It talks about against His name. How would it be against His name? Very often in the New Testament, when you see something about the name, what comes to mind? What's that representing?
Authority.
Authority. They are blaspheming against God's authority. But then also blaspheming His tabernacle. What's His tabernacle?
The
dwelling place.
And what does the New Testament say that is?
Church.
Church. His people. They're blaspheming his people. Blaspheming God, his very being and existence. Blaspheming his authority. Blaspheming his people. And also blaspheming what?
Those who dwell in heaven.
Who would that be?
All the saints. The host of saints.
Okay, so you got the 24 elders already been represented, and you've got the 144,000, you know, being represented there before God. Blaspheming the saints, blaspheming even those who have gone on before, could also be blaspheming against angels or the Holy Spirit. Anything that's associated with God and heavenly, in the heavenly realm, they can blaspheme against. How long does his authority last? 42 months, and that's the number, 3.5 years or 1,260 days. It keeps coming up again and again. And again, that is the idea of a time of intense persecution. It's indefinite. You can't say that it's a specific number of years. It's just saying it's short, it's intense, it's going to be there, then it's going to come to an end. All right, so it's granted to make war with the saints. Again, that echoes out of Daniel chapter 7 about being granted to make war. Now, who is he over? Verse 7. Given authority over every tribe, tongue, and nation. All right, this is one of those places that I would point to if someone wants to say, well, the book of Revelation applies to the Jews in the 70 AD. The Jews didn't have power over every tongue, authority, and nation. It just doesn't match up. It matches up with Rome. Like, all over the place, it matches with Rome. It doesn't match with other scenarios that people have put forth. All right, so verses 8 to 10 then. All who dwell on the earth will worship him, whose names are where or not where. Okay, those who are not written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Now, there's two different translations there too as well. It's either the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world or people's names written in the Book of Life from the foundation of the world. Now, I shy away from the second one because it sounds too Calvinistic to me. I see more as the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. This plan of salvation was there before the world was brought into being or brought into existence. But be that as it may, what he's getting at, verses 8 to 10, is there is this clear dividing line between the faithful and the unfaithful. Those dedicated to God and those not dedicated to God. Those who will worship the beast and those who refuse to worship the beast. All right. Any other thoughts down through 10? All right, let's read 11. 11 through 18. As we will wrap up there with the mark of the beast, the number of the beast. Go ahead, Clint.
Then I saw another beast rising out of the earth, and it had two horns like a lamb, and it spoke like a dragon. It exercises all the authority of the first beast in its presence, and makes the earth and its inhabitants worship the first beast whose mortal wound was healed. It performs great signs, even making fire come down from heaven to earth in front of people. And by the signs that it is allowed to work in the presence of the beast, it deceives those who dwell on the earth, telling them to make an image of a beast that was wounded by the sword and yet lived. And it was allowed to give breath to the image of the beast, so that the image of the beast might even speak and might cause those who would not worship the image of the beast to be slain. Also, it causes all, both small and great, both rich and poor, both free and slave, to be marked on the right hand or the forehead. So that no one can buy or sell unless he has the mark, that is, the name of the beast or the number of its name. This calls for wisdom. Let the one who has understanding calculate the number of the beast or the number of a man, and his number is 666.
Okay. So, question number 4 I'd ask, can you identify this second beast, this beast that rises up out of the earth? It's almost like it's rising up. You can picture it rising up out of Asia Minor. Here's one that comes up out of the sea, and it's very terrible looking and all that. Then another one pops up out of the earth.
Is it possible we're talking about false religions or apostate because he refers to it as a lamb, so it has an appearance of being religious?
Okay. It's like a lamb, so it's purporting, in a sense, to be the Savior, to parody the Lamb of God. That's the idea here, and it is carrying that religious sense, as Ron mentioned. And really, maybe a way to look at it is, here's a rival to the Lamb of God. You've got the Lamb of God beginning to be talked about, you know, in that language in Revelation 5, and here you've got this other beast that looks like a lamb, but he's really not a lamb, right? He's a ferocious beast that has come up. So you've got this beast, and would anybody add anything else to this? Because we've got another connection. Go ahead.
So going on with the description of the beast, we also see that while looking like a lamb, he speaks like a dragon.
Right.
Previously, I mean, in current days, dragons are kind of, everybody wants to watch movies about dragons. They're powerful. They're usually secretly good after once you get to know them type deal. But when you look back at the Bible, when you look back at the older myths and legends, the dragon was seen more as if it was deceitful, beckoning, manipulative, rather than powerful and consuming. Mm-hmm.
It says that he exercises authority over the first beast.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So is he now dominant?
Yes. Yes, we're going to dig into that in just a minute. But this dragon, or this beast rather, in Revelation 16, Revelation 19, Revelation 20, he's specifically identified as the false prophet. So this is the false religion, Chris.
As the lamb, as it's talked about, I believe it's meaning that he's going forth completely deceived.
Yes. Yes, he looks like a lamb, but speaking like the dragon here, that deceit that's going out, destructive, vicious, ferocious, coming after people. So he's speaking these lies and deceit, authority. He's got, let me see where it is there. He exercises all the authority of the first beast there in verse 12 in his presence. Anybody want to expound on that? Because I've got some things to add, but. Because this is actually representing a very specific entity or thing. Okay, emperor worship, the emperor cult. In Asia Minor, there was a particular devotion to the worship of the emperor, even more so than in Rome. Romans sort of looked at it as a practical thing, maybe a little bit of a superstitious thing, but the people in Asia Minor took it very seriously, and there was something called the Asia Commune, which was the cult of the emperor, and the priests in this cult had great power, and their job was to prop up the emperor as a deity and to get people to pledge devotion and to worship him and do all of those things for him. That was their very purpose. And then the emperor, of course, would look out for them. It's sort of like in the Dark Ages or the Middle Ages, when you have Roman Catholic power in Europe, the Pope supported the kings and the kings supported the Pope. And they worked in conjunction with one another. And that's what's happening here. You've got the governmental side in the beast out of the sea, representing Roman power and Roman emperors and probably Domitian himself. And then you've got on the other side this other beast that is the religious side. That's the enforcement side of getting people to pledge this devotion. And if you don't do that, then you are in trouble, which we'll talk more about here in just a minute. But they are compelling people to worship the beast, to give that. They looked at this as patriotism. It was patriotism for them. That you had to go in and you had to get a pinch of incense and you had to burn that to the emperor. And if you did that, you are a patriot. But if you didn't do that, you actually hate Rome. You're an enemy of Rome. You want Rome to fall. You know, today, we can get those kinds of things from people. That we're patriots, but man, I do not like what's going on there, whether it's in state capital or national capital and the things, the direction the country's going. We may not like that, but that doesn't mean we're enemies of our country. Clint?
I was going to say, this is a kind of a combination of church and state power. Mm-hmm. And sometimes we can kind of see where the founding fathers of this nation are trying to break away from that. But also, like you were saying, emperor worship, or when you wanted to do trade or have commerce or be a part of the guild or the trade that you wanted to be in. We talk about this in the first part of Revelation, that the churches and their pressure to bow down, to do the incense, to be marked, to be one of the nation. Mm-hmm. And if you weren't, then you were excommunicated, or you couldn't do business, you couldn't do trade.
Yeah, yeah. We'll get there in just a second. 13 and 14, you know, it talks about he performs great signs so that even he makes fire come down from heaven. Wait a second. He's performing signs? What about that?
It's been done previously.
Give me an example.
Well, under the old law, of course, with Pharaoh.
Okay. Pharaoh's magicians, they could do their things, but they could only go so far. Anyone else?
Simon,
right? Acts 8, it says that he convinced the people he was some great power of God. But then Philip comes along with the true miracles, and all of a sudden they realize there's a difference here. And even Simon was like, yeah, they're not faking it like me. But this is something else. So yeah, so they had their magic tricks, so to speak. They had those, and they were telling people, it's the power of the gods with us. And so that would try to convince the people, the lying signs and wonders. You know, Paul talks about in 2 Thessalonians about this strong delusion. If people want to believe a lie, God's going to let that happen. They don't love the truth? Well, there's only one other option for you to buy into, and that's a lie. So he's allowing that to happen, and they're convincing men that they've got this great power. Question number 5 I ask, what's the beast's purpose? 13 through 15. What's he doing?
He's deceiving all that follow him.
He is deceiving them. And verse 15 says that he gives breath to the image of the beast. So he's putting life into that first beast to give it that influence, that control over people. They're doing it through religion here. Now then, verses 16 through 18, let's notice this. So he causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive the mark on their foreheads, or in the right hand on their foreheads, that no one may buy or sell except one that has a mark, or the name of the beast, or the number of his name. So that's Social Security cards, and that is the UPC code on your bread and cereal, and that is your credit card, and that's your bank account number, or if there's a chip they're going to implant in you, and that's going to be the mark of the beast. Right?
QR codes,
and who knows what it'll be, you know, 5 years from now. Here's the point. People are utterly ridiculous and let their minds go completely wild about these kinds of things. Don't get caught up in that. Don't do it. Remember, to whom was this letter written? Okay, when? Okay, you said present day. You meant present when the letter was written. Okay, the way you worded that, I heard it as Christians now. But yeah, no. Yes, Christians in the first century living in Asia Minor.
Under Roman rule.
Under Roman rule. They did not have UPCs. Okay, they didn't have it. So when he's talking about the mark of the beast, he's not talking about 21st century or 20th century technology or things that are happening now. He's just not talking about that. He's talking about something completely different. And when you go back and you look at the history of this time, they did have certificates that they had to show so they could be involved in trade. So they could buy things, so they could sell things. And that certificate was only going to be given to you if you were a part of that emperor worship. If you were signed off on by those priests who enforced that cult worship of the emperor. And so that's what he's talking about here. He's really not even talking about a physical mark on the body.
Yeah, and to me it's your head and your hand. What you think and what you do.
Mm-hmm.
You use your hands to do whatever you're going to do. But the head and the hand, the two aspects, how you think and how you work.
And those are two of the things we notice about people right away. Mm-hmm. First thing we're going to notice about people is their face, and then we see their hands working. And you'll see they're devoted to the beast, they're not devoted to the beast.
Well, I don't know if you're going there or not, but in Deuteronomy chapter 11, verses 18 and 19, it says exactly that whenever you do the work of God, specifically to the Jews at that time, it says, "You shall therefore impress these words of mine on your heart and on your soul. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlets on your forehead. You shall teach them to your sons, talking of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk along the road, when you lie down, and when you rise up." So just that total acceptance of God's law is a sign upon your hand, upon the work that you do, and upon what you accept also. It seems like he's using that, again, for the blasphemy part that we're talking about with these beasts.
Yeah, the way they're thinking is coming out in their lives, what guides their life.
Well, and the way it's depicted here, at that time, slaves were branded. Mm-hmm. So you were saying you were a slave. Mm-hmm. It was a way of saying you're a slave to this emperor.
And how they would put it is, this is your pledge of loyalty to the emperor. This is how you prove that you're devoted to him, and you're a patriot, and you're going to support him, and that will allow you to engage in commerce. And so, of course, Christians were like, no, we're not doing that. So that hurt them economically. They couldn't be a part of that open economy. They would have to go to an underground economy, essentially. So all that's happening. Now, the mark of the beast. I asked question 6. What do you think it means? Very good. All right. So there's some people who want to associate this with Nero and about his Hebrew name, and if you assign numbers to that, then it comes out to 666. Well, for me, that's a challenge because this is written to people who are not Hebrews, and they live in Asia Minor, and they would have to do all that. Figure that out. An alternate understanding, and maybe we never ultimately know, but you've got the dragon, you've got the beast of the sea, and you've got the beast of the earth. You have an unholy trinity here. So you got three, right? So what's the perfect number? Seven. What's just short of perfect? Six. Right? So to me, this is more pointing toward the idea that these three are trying to come together and exercise this divine power, but they're falling just short of that. Instead of 777, 666, these three sixes. Each of them are falling just short. So you have the true Trinity, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, talked about in the book before, and you have this false trinity, this counterpart to the true Godhead. All right, anybody want to posit anything else? Ron?
Just going to say, as you point that out, Stephen, it's identifying those who are worshiping the beast
And so they have an identity, and as we studied previously in the seventh chapter, that those that were of God's were sealed on their forehead. So they have an identity.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Yeah, you've got the, you know, God the Father on his throne, you've got the dragon. You've got the lamb, you've got the beast, you've got the Holy Spirit, you have another beast, you have the mark of God or the seal of God, and here you have the mark of the beast or the seal of the beast. It's just giving that contrast between the two. All right. Well, Lord willing, moving on forward, chapter 14, next week. And thank you all.